And now the smelly depths of our aging infrastructure. Our intrepid NewsHour science correspondent Miles O'Brien takes a deep dive into some very murky waters.
I'm suiting up for a stomach-turning trek beneath the streets of Detroit.
All right, duct tape here. Seal me up tight, just to be sure.
Okay.
Repelling into a repelling place, a huge sewer line called the Detroit River Interceptor. In short order, I'm knee deep in that which rhymes with it. You sure wouldn't want to drop anything valuable in here, like my glasses.
Oh, glasses. Good.
Oh well, bye bye bifocals, right? Well, watch this gutsy barehanded retrieval from a river of revulsion. Sewer worker Roberto Sanchez may not be squeamish about what flows below us, but he is worried about the cracks above our heads. In Detroit, there are 3,500 miles of sewer lines, some of them dating back to the mid-19th century.
I gotta get them. So these are some of the things they really gotta watch out for, these leaks coming in here. That's a big concern.
The crumbling pipes offer a glimpse at a huge national engineering challenge that is largely unseen and unappreciated, unless you're in the business of keeping the water flowing.
What's the plan for repairing something like this?
Repairing is grouting. It's called grouting.
Yeah.
Fill them in.
Sue McCormick, director of the Detroit Water and Sewerage Department, describes her profession as...
silent service.
What does that mean?
The public took for granted that if they turned the water tap on, the water came, and if they flushed the toilet, it went away.
Is there a sense in the community of people of your peers across the nation that there is a crisis looming beneath the streets?
Absolutely.
What kind of crisis?
I won't say a crisis of epic proportions, but a crisis that is based on the belief that we have deferred replacement in the public systems, and that ultimately we're going to see potential significant rises in failures.
Unfortunately, it usually takes a big failure to get people to pay attention. Politicians don't win elections by promising new sewers. And the $800 billion in federal stimulus money doled out starting back in 2009 offered lots of money for bridges and roads, but only $5 billion, or one half of 1%, to the pipes that lie beneath. It's enough to prompt the silent service to start making some noise. The American Society of Civil Engineers issued a U.S. infrastructure report card in 2009. The grade for the nation's water and sewer systems? D-. Greg DiLoretto is president of the organization.
What does a D- mean?
Well, in this particular case, a D- would mean that we're short $84 billion over the next 8 years to bring it to a good condition over what we're currently spending.
Detroit is home to the largest wastewater treatment plant in the country. It handles as much as 700 million gallons a day. Everything that Detroiters and their neighbors flush down the drain ends up here. Everything.
But what kinds of things?
We get a lot of condoms, superhero action figures, Cheeto bags, you name it.
It all ends up here.
It ends up here.
Civil engineer Sam Smalley is the man in charge. Here, it is a round-the-clock struggle to screen out the debris, separate the solids, let the sludge settle, and treat the water before it is dumped in the river. The sludge is dried out and then either incinerated or trucked to landfills. Smalley must keep a creaky old plant running while adhering to a federal court mandate to meet standards set by the Clean Water Act and managing $600 million in improvements.
You're trying to do two things at once, aren't you?
Well, we're trying to do several things at once. The regulations only get tighter or more stringent, and so that's a challenge, and we are maintaining compliance today. 2 years ago, we couldn't say the same thing.
That's where the Baby Creek plant comes in. It is designed to stop a huge source of water pollution, combined sewage overflows. Years ago, sewage systems were built to carry runoff during a rainstorm in addition to wastewater. But when rainfall exceeds the capacity of the system, it overflows, sending an untreated mix of sewage and rainwater straight into the river. Baby Creek is essentially a sophisticated holding tank designed to intercept the overflow so it can be treated later.
So are you testing it before it goes out so you know what your solution levels are and stuff?
15 years ago, Detroit discharged 20 billion gallons of combined sewage overflow into the river each year. This and eight other plants have captured 94% of that dirty water at a cost of $1 billion. But a plan to eliminate the last 6% by building a big holding tunnel would cost $800 million. And in Detroit, where poverty is endemic and the population is declining, they're desperately trying alternatives, like building green alleys which absorb rainwater and encouraging industry to plant so-called green roofs.
That's what's affordable for us, I think, in the short term, and I think it's the best use of public investment in the long term.
As opposed to the $800 million tunnel idea.
Correct.
Detroit is looking to save money by outsourcing work to crews that line crumbling old pipes with a polymer sleeve that hardens soon after a resin is applied. Much cheaper and easier than digging. The technique is now widely used all across the nation.
This is a fiberglass mat. It's going to be a 48-inch long kit when we're done.
I went to San Antonio, Texas, to see how they are managing wastewater and watched a repair crew there install a liner in a short section of a small sewer pipe. They are using a small camera on a tractor to find problems early. Joseph Villarreal is the televising foreman.
You can't help but think about doctors doing heart surgery, you know?
Pretty much.
Right? It's like opening up the arteries, right? Using those.
Exactly. Right? If I can describe a sewer main to anyone, it's cholesterol and arteries. And grease inside the sewer main is cholesterol and arteries.
Yeah.
But San Antonio is trying to prevent the surgery in the first place. The city is learning conservation can help solve the infrastructure dilemma, in no small part thanks to a blind salamander. 20 years ago, concern about the fate of the endangered species prompted a federal court ruling that limited how much San Antonio could siphon from an underground aquifer. Necessity became the mother of invention. Robert Puente is president and CEO of the San Antonio Water Service.
In the last 25 years, San Antonio is using the same amount of water as it did back then.
With a population growth of what?
67% more customers.
You're doing something right.
We're doing something right, and that's water conservation.
Puente has pushed individual conservation, giving away efficient toilets, educating the public about saving water, and encouraging xeriscaping, or landscaping that doesn't need irrigation.
It's been cleaned up and stuff. This just crushed granite.
Earl Smith started out not wanting to mow a lawn anymore.
Yeah, that's just English ivy.
Yeah.
And now, talk about maintenance. Yeah. You mow that once a year.
And now his home is surrounded by a beautiful garden that needs no mowing and nothing more than rainwater.
So do you think collectively we can solve all of our water woes by planting like this?
I don't know about all. I'm not a big all or none person. But I think we could to make a tremendous impact on taking water out of the discussion as a threatened resource.
That philosophy is imbued into the way they treat their dirty water here. In fact, they call their largest wastewater treatment plant a recycling center.
This is the only plant in the country that recycles or reuses all of the processed residuals that come out of this plant.
Scientist and senior analyst Greg Eckhart gave me a tour.
We're recycling this water, we're recycling the solids and the gas. No other place is doing that. And we've got the solar farm out here.
Just for good measure.
Between all those things, there's no other place in Texas that's any greener than this plant.
Really? A green sewage treatment plant? Eckhart showed me how they handle water here, clarifying, scrubbing with bacteria and microorganisms fed by oxygen, and then clarifying again.
After this, we also do a filtration process. We can meet all the standards without that. But we do that just to polish the water to give it that extra shine.
Polish the water.
Polish, that's what you call it.
Yeah?
Polish the water.
Extra shine.
Yeah.
30% of that polished water goes into the San Antonio River. The remaining 70% is captured and reused. The polished yet non-potable water in the purple pipes supplies manufacturers and irrigates golf courses, and even keeps the famous river walk from becoming a dry riverbed walk.
The water that you don't use, you don't have to treat. So there's also savings in our wastewater treatment plants. So much so that we closed one of our plants. Instead of expanding, although during this growth, we actually closed one of our four plants.
Really?
Yes.
The city is growing and you can shut down plants.
Tremendous amount of savings.
So maybe the best way our aging water systems can avoid flunking the grade is by finding ways to use them less.
Usually a camera would be doing the job. We don't have enough cameras that walk these, you know, these big pipes.
Right.
So we gotta do it.
And it wouldn't hurt if we stopped taking for granted the unsung heroes who keep the stuff flowing.
Miles blogs about his plunge into Detroit's sewer system. You can read about it on our science page.